Hello everyone, this is Professor De Angelo and welcome to the final installation of the Early American History podcast that I've put together. Hopefully this has been helpful for you to get through the various eras of early American history. Take a minute to note that the resources that I've used for this have come from gentlemen like this one, Mr. Tindall, and authors of a book, American Narrative History. So when the Civil War ended, Victorious Union faced an unprecedented challenge. How to incorporate rebellious states back into the Union. And it did not end all the issues that had led up to that fact. In fact, it created more. How were Confederate states to be treated? Conquered provinces, forgiven prodigal sons, traitors to the United States. So how long was it going to take to bring the southern states back into the Union? So all of these issues were significant. So the North had really sort of done rather well. I think it's important to remember that well over 90-some% of the fighting took place in southern locations. There were some skirmishes in places like Vermont and in Colorado and out here where I am in California. But for the most part, this was a southern war. And so the North was able to continue with much of its economic development. And while there were certainly issues that came up, there really wasn't too awful much damage to the North. But the South was literally blown into the Stone Age. There are some historians that would tell you that the full economic recovery of the South doesn't really complete until the 1980s, which is, you know, well over 100 years of history until that's taken place. And much of that has to do with how the South, just even after the Civil War, refuses to just accept defeat and move forward. Now, one of the most pressing issues, of course, was what to do with quite literally millions of freed persons. Now, the Emancipation Proclamation had abolished slavery in the South and had freed about $4 billion worth of slaves. And the South was going to have to rebuild without them. And this was going to be a major problem. But for Northerners, who, to be quite frank about it, did not want millions of freed slaves to come, you know, pouring into the northern cities. They just didn't. This speaks to the sort of what I would call tacit or latent racism among Northerners. They didn't want them competing for jobs. They didn't want them moving into their neighborhoods. And so the dilemma, of course, was that these are individuals who did not know freedom, did not know what it meant, did not know what it would entail as far as their own responsibilities. And in order to help freedmen adapt to their new lives, Congress created the Freedmen's Bureau, which aimed to provide them with the basic necessities as they adjusted. The Confederate Army was beaten, but in many areas, Southern people were still unbowed. And, these newly freed individuals were illiterate in most cases, did not own property, had no assets of which to speak. It was a major dilemma. Many freed slaves didn't want to leave their communities because their separation from family members was so traumatic that most of them insisted on trying to locate family members. So the Freedmen's Bureau was a way of helping them with all of these things: housing, clothing, education, and family reunification. And the Freedmen's Bureau was really most successful in the area of education, providing literacy classes for newly freed slaves and to try to teach them certain skills to help them in their new lives of freedom. This was a very big deal. And so the Southerners, however, had to find a way to transform themselves. And the Union forces that were, I would argue, compelled to stay in the South as an occupying force were not going to be viewed very fondly by Southerners. And so for many of the people in the South, there was an end, but not a conclusion to the war. And so for Southern whites, there was resentment and bitterness, the so-called lost cause. And for many Southern blacks, it was the idea or the dilemma of being legally free but socially bound. And you'll talk a bit about this in terms of how the Southerners continued to keep people bound. The most significant way, of course, was through something called sharecropping. For many slaves, once they were freed, the level of skill that they had was very limited to agriculture. So for many, the most immediate vehicle for gaining any income at all was to sign an agreement with their former masters in many cases, to share the crops of the land. They were basically going to sign on in debt to their former slave owner and be legally bound to the land unless they could pay off their debt, which of course was very difficult to do. And so that and the crop lien system that gets implemented by Southern whites, and I would argue Northerners who come down and run some of these plantations, it's going to be a really a legal form of slavery. And so now in 1863, Lincoln had issued a plan, and I think it's kind of important to always remember that Lincoln was trying to put together a post-war reality that he believed would be best for the country, but in all honesty, would also be good for him and the Republican Party. It's always important to remember that prior to the war, the Republicans had virtually zero support in the Southern states. So in the border states, true, but in the Southern states, not. And so Lincoln, in 1863, at the same time that the proclamation for emancipating slavery took place, the emancipation for amnesty and Reconstruction also took place. And Lincoln was conniving ways, if you will, what I call Lincoln thinking, which is that if he figured out a way to split the Southern white community from the sort of rank and file soldier versus the officers and the elite political people of the South, that he could probably create a Southern white Republican base. And so Lincoln had proposed the emancipation of slaves at the same time as he proposed the amnesty. And what he was basically saying, in my opinion, the way I look at Lincoln thinking, is that he had said that he was only going to free slaves in states still in rebellion. So for the Southerners at the time, they could have taken their state out of the Confederacy and repented and returned to the Union, and their slaves would have stayed slaves. Now, at this point, and I'm sorry, so when Lincoln said that he was offering a lenient plan, which we call the Lincoln Plan, or the 10% plan, is simply that 10% of the male population of the state had to pledge allegiance to the Union and to the Constitution. And then the state would be allowed to simply return to the Union. There wasn't going to be any quote-unquote readmitting a state, Because in Lincoln's logic at the beginning of the war was that the state didn't have the authority to leave the Union. People can. You can pack your stuff and move. But the state cannot. It was bound by the Constitution to remain within the Union. And so Lincoln offered this very lenient proposals. But the Congress didn't view it that way. And they're going to propose something called the Wade-Davis Bill. So, for instance, when Tennessee, Arkansas, and Louisiana met the guidelines under Lincoln's 10% plan, Congress refused to accept them, stating that Reconstruction was a legislative, not an executive function. This is an interesting kind of thing here, right? Executive orders, something that we deal with quite a bit in American politics today. So the Congress proposed Wade-Davis Bill, also called the 50% plan, which called for even more stringent demands on the South. But this was vetoed by Lincoln in an interesting sort of tactic called a pocket veto. And this is a procedure that is permissible under the Constitution because any pending legislation when Congress adjourns dies. So Lincoln didn't actually sign a veto message in this respect. The leaders of the Republicans in the Congress timed their proposal so that it would be on the president's desk when the Congress would be adjourning. So the president merely refused to act on the legislation. The rule in the Constitution is the president has 10 business days to act on any legislation. And if he doesn't, and the Congress is still in session, it becomes law without signature. But if he fails to act and the Congress adjourns, the legislation dies. And it's referred to as a pocket veto, sort of the imagery of the president sticking it in his pocket and forgetting about it. And then it just sort of dies, a natural death. So now, in retaliation to that, the Congress issued what was called the Wade-Davis Manifesto, which accused Lincoln of violating his constitutional authority, which is very interesting, given sort of the hero status of Lincoln at the time. So what we have to look at here is that Lincoln, on some level, was an incredibly popular person because he had freed the slaves and saved the Union. And yet, there was a rising popular view that the South needed to be severely punished. What may have seemed reasonable to Lincoln in 1862 when he was drafting these ideas of emancipation and amnesty were very different than the realities at the end of the war. Literally hundreds of thousands of more people had died in very gruesome ways. And and a large number of people in the North resented emancipation because they felt that it was going to give too much status and agency to Africans that many Northerners did not believe were citizens. So the question really became, could one man heal this split nation? There's no question of his popularity. But there's a tendency sometimes for us today when we sort of venerate and idealize Lincoln's presidency that, you know, it's difficult to think of people having problems with Lincoln. And yet there were a lot of people at the time. And so Lincoln's assassination by John Wilkes Booth, a Southern sympathizer, on April 14th, really changed things a great deal. It was Good Friday, and other members of Lincoln's cabinet were targeted. So it was a genuine conspiracy. The gentlemen down at the bottom there are your main conspirators. Wilkes Booth is in the middle there, and all of the conspirators were put to death. I should say mercilessly put to death. Wilkes Booth himself is hunted down like an animal. They find him cornered in a barn, and set it on fire. And when he comes running out for his, you know, own safety, he's shot through the neck, severing his spinal cord. And he dies a rather slow and painful death. There were several targets on the evening of the assassination. And this is something I think that bears a relating on many levels. The president of the United States and the vice president of the United States were both targeted that evening. The assassin meant for Vice President Johnson chickened out. The president was at Ford's Theater with his wife, and I believe a niece and her fiance, an officer, a captain in the army. But that wasn't the original plan. Ulysses S. Grant and his wife were supposed to be at Ford's Theater that evening with the Lincolns. And Mrs. Grant insisted that they not go because Mrs. Grant hated Mrs. Lincoln and didn't want to spend any time with her. Now, one of the assassins, I believe it's the gentleman on the left, actually managed to get into the house of Secretary of State William Seward. Now, what's interesting about Seward's situation is that he had already been severely injured in a carriage accident. His horses had been spooked and tore out. I believe one of his children may have died in it, but he broke his neck. He was in a body cast or a, sort of like a metal implement thing and recovering from a near-death experience in his home. The assassin got into the house, struggled with the son, stabbed the son multiple times, and then went into the secretary's bedroom where he attempted to stab him to death and stabs him multiple times and is able to escape. He was only found when he tried to sneak back into Washington, D.C. to go back to the boarding house where he had been staying, and federal agents were there questioning the woman who owned the facility, who, by the way, is hanged for her complicity in the conspiracy. I believe altogether 9 people are going to be executed for this. I mean, it's just a nightmare of experience. I would suggest if you ever want in Doris Goodman's piece, Team of Rivals, she has an excellent chapter on the assassination, which gives you all of the gory details. And what many people don't realize about this is that the purpose of this conspiracy was to create a genuine national constitutional crisis. If the president and the vice president were both killed, there was nothing in the Constitution dictating who took the presidency. Now, the assumption has always been that it would probably be the Secretary of State, but there were other people who believed it was the Speaker of the House. And others who thought they would be the president pro tem of the Senate. This doesn't get resolved, by the way, until the 25th Amendment gets passed, which is sometime in the 1960s, I believe. So this would have been a genuine constitutional dilemma for the country. And Booth tried to put this one off, it was an unbelievable assassination. And the deadly blow was only suffered by Lincoln, who was shot in the head, again, lived through the night, dying in the morning, a slow and, I can only imagine, agonizing death. And for Booth, his vision of a Southern Phoenix type of resurrection never happens. He goes into the booth, as you can see above, shoots the president. The idea was that he was to leap over that banister that you see there in the picture And if you've ever been in Ford's Theater, that balcony is quite literally right above the stage. And John Wilkes Booth was what we would today call a B actor, right? His brother, Julius Booth, was a very well-known Shakespearean performer who had chosen to leave the South when they seceded and instead went to New York. John Wilkes Booth, who also performed extensively and was rather well-known, remained obviously loyal to the South and had actually received his mail through the Ford's Theater. And so his entering into the theater that evening would not have created any suspicion. And the idea was that he would leap over that banister that you see and that he would land on the stage right at the moment in the play, Our American Cousin, where they have what is called a showstopper. The performance was going to have a funny line and everybody was going to stand up and roar and clap and applaud. And at that moment, he would fire the gun and jump on the stage. And before anybody could realize it, he would be across the stage, out the back door. And at the stage door, he had arranged for a horse to be tethered. And so everything was timed. Unfortunately, Booth did not anticipate that the captain that you see standing there would struggle with him. He got off balance when he jumped over that banister. You see a draping of the American flag. It was actually bunting that was along the banister of the balcony. However, his spur catches on to the banner. It flips him, and he lands awkwardly on the stage, breaking his leg, which is why we say break a leg. But he does not have the same mobility that he had planned. And in fact, Mrs. Lincoln's screams brings silence to the theater. And as he hobbles across the stage, he yells out "Sic Semper Tyrannis," which is the motto of Virginia, such it is with tyrants, a line from Julius Caesar when Brutus is stabbing Caesar in the back. Now, what many people don't know is that Booth really lingers in this sort of fantasy that he had reignited the lost cause. But when he's in hiding in the woods in the marshes of Virginia, he's one of his conspirators brings him a newspaper from Richmond. And he opens it anticipating that he's going to read all of the accolades and idolizations of his deed. And instead, the newspaper is lamenting the loss of Lincoln and condemning Booth for having committed such a heinous crime. And this is most likely because Virginia, which is a southern state, had suffered the most. In the fighting, most of the fighting was in Virginia, and most of the devastation was in Virginia. And so for many of the elites of Virginia, they knew that Lincoln was offering them a really lenient Reconstruction deal, and that if Lincoln were to die or not be president anymore and get replaced by the more radical elements of his party, that they were going to suffer a great deal. And now Booth had literally confirmed all of the suspicions and conspiracy theories that had been permeating throughout the North, that the South was going to do something to reverse the results on the battlefield, and they were going to try to take back their cause at any price. And here, Lincoln's assassination does exactly that. And so we get what I refer to as the radicalization of the Union. So within the Republican Party, and I know this sounds strange because today we think of the Republican Party as a conservative party, but the Republicans were basically a left-wing party. There were conservative Republicans, what we would call moderates today. But the political spectrum within the party spread from the sort of conservative, pro-business, anti-immigrant element to a far left group called the Radicals, who believed not only in the emancipation of slaves, but for their full incorporation as citizens with voting rights and equal representation under the law. So Lincoln's assassination changed the face of Reconstruction. His successor, Andrew Johnson, was not strong enough to counter the demands of the radical Republicans in the Congress. So Johnson's background is somewhat unique as a Southerner. If you'll remember in a previous podcast many weeks ago, we had talked about the hierarchy of the South and how very immobile it was. The ability for a landless white, for instance, to make his way up into the planter class was virtually impossible. And yet Johnson is one of those rare examples. He was functionally illiterate. In fact, his wife, if I remember correctly, educated him and allowed him to get the literacy that he needed in order to pass the bar exam. And he was from the state of Tennessee and was a member of the Congress. And when Tennessee voted to leave the Union, Johnson voted to leave Tennessee and instead went and joined the Union Army and led a regiment of Tennessee volunteers to retake Tennessee. When Tennessee was reincorporated into the Union by force in 1862, Johnson was named the Governor General of that state. Now, if you'll recall in the previous chapter, we talked about how Lincoln had to run for re-election in 1864. And in order to do that, he needed to have the support of a broader voting base. So the Democrats had split between war Democrats and peace Democrats. And the war Democrats that supported fighting until the South relented was led by Andrew Johnson. So in 1864, the Republicans and the war Democrats formed the Union Party, and Johnson was the vice presidential candidate. But now, Johnson was the president of the United States without a vice president at all. And he was, philosophically speaking, a Southern Democrat. And what that meant was he believed in a small federal government and he was racist. He did not believe in equal rights for blacks. He was against slavery, but he was not necessarily an individual who believed in equal rights for African Americans. He certainly did not want them to vote, and he wasn't in support, really, of them even having citizenship. Now, what Johnson does is he decided to stick with Lincoln's 10% plan, and he's going to do this because he believed that the obvious hero status now of Lincoln. Lincoln was not only now the war hero of the war, but he was now a martyr to the cause of the Union and for the ending of slavery. And Johnson believed that he could simply sell the 10% plan over the objections of the Congress by saying to the American people, this is what the slain president wanted, and in his honor, we should continue it. As a fig leaf, perhaps, to those who were more vengeful, he offered what I call the plus plan. And that is that all the states had to adopt the 13th Amendment. This is the last thing that Lincoln was able to sign and send to the states, which was the abolition of slavery. But more importantly, Johnson believed that the real rebels of the South were not the everyday Southerner, but in fact that 10% elite, the planter class, the very wealthy of the South. And so as part of his 10% plus, it wouldn't be just any 10% of the male population. It was to be the very top elite 10% of the male population who would have to take this pledge. In addition, every one of them had to write a letter to Johnson and ask for a pardon. and they had to pay a price, a penalty or a fine, however you want to pay it, pronounce it, was to be paid to the government based on the size of your assets and property. So this was a full-on punishment. And now what happens is Southerners decide to take full advantage of this. And what they did is they started to send representatives. Johnson just started signing pardons left and right like nobody's business. He was getting his jollies just by watching all these planters who basically had refused to acknowledge him as one of their own to have to now grovel at his feet. And so what happens is these quote-unquote reconstructed states send their delegates to the Congress, many of whom were members of the Confederate Congress. So, Alexander Stevens, who was the vice president of the Confederacy, was actually elected as a member of the Georgia delegation. And in absolute, refusal, the Congress actually literally locked the doors of the Capitol building and refused to seat the delegates from the Southern states. And now this is going to create a huge face-off between the president and the radicals. But what was the most pressing problem, really, for Johnson is that there was no real precedent on what to do. And so Johnson kept Lincoln's cabinet. And so there was only one Democrat, if I remember correctly, on Lincoln's cabinet. And he had become a rather big Lincoln supporter, if you will. And so Johnson was not only not getting along with the Congress, he wasn't getting along with his own cabinet. And so this brings us to the midterm elections in 1866. So a third of the Senate and all of the House of Representatives are up for a vote. And Johnson decides to go and on a speaking tour to support the candidacy of Democrats and even in moderate Republicans in order to support his presidential reconstruction plan. And he referred to it as his swing around the circle. And so for Johnson, this is a major catastrophe. The results, right, is that the radical element of the Republican Party not only gained majorities in both houses, but they got a veto-proof majority in both houses. And so we end up getting radical or military reconstruction. So Johnson had vetoed the civil rights laws that had been passed, and the Congress was able to override those. And the Civil Rights Acts were directed specifically at the anti-black and vigilante behavior in the South. Thousands, and I mean thousands of African Americans were being slain, lynched, intimidated, re-enslaved, and the Congress was trying to address that with a Civil Rights Act, which was basically giving African Americans citizenship in the United States and affording them all the rights of due process. And Johnson, as I said earlier, was essentially a racist who didn't believe that African Americans were equal and therefore could not be considered citizens. And so even though they were able to make that law, radicals in the Congress realized that the only way to solidify those changes was to amend the Constitution, and we get what's called the 14th Amendment. Now, the 14th Amendment becomes really critical for all of us as Americans because it does two things. It establishes what is, in fact, a citizen of the United States, which is either an individual born on American soil, which basically meant every African American at the time was a citizen, and or having a parent of American citizenship. And so the only other way was through a process called naturalization. And the second element here was the idea that as a citizen of the United States, we are all to be afforded due process of law, regardless of where we are. And this gives us a notion referred to as incorporation. And incorporation means that the states also have to obey and live up to the Bill of Rights. And so this was meant to instill to all Americans, but specifically freed slaves, the status as citizens along with all other Americans. Now, the problem for Johnson, of course, is that radical Reconstruction broke the South up into districts, each with a governor general and an occupying army. Now, this Reconstruction was based primarily on the 50% planner, Wade Davis, except that now it has a military side to it. States had to completely rewrite their constitutions. They had to go through these stages of ratifying the 13th, 14th, and later the 15th Amendments, which gave black males the right to vote, and to support the freedmen bureaus. They also had to repudiate all Southern debts related to the war. And more importantly, they had to take this pledge of allegiance to the Union of the United States. And that's why if you notice our Pledge of Allegiance, if you take the words under God out of the pledge, you begin to understand its relevance in the post-Civil War era, right? I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. This is a very direct link to the Civil War. And so... now, the biggest problem for Johnson is that this military project called Reconstruction was going to be run not by the president as commander-in-chief, but actually the Secretary of War. And this was Secretary Stanton. And so Johnson started to contrive a way to get rid of Secretary Stanton. And when this was starting to happen, the Republicans passed a law called the Tenure of Office Act. Now, this has no real constitutional standing at all, but essentially it stated that a president could not remove a member of his cabinet from office without the approval of the Senate. So, as you may know, the Senate has to confirm any appointments to the cabinet, but this was saying that in order to get rid of somebody, you had to get the approval of the Senate. Now, Johnson vetoed it, they overrode his veto, and he fired Stanton anyway. And so, now, we get the first impeachment of a sitting president. Something that will probably sound very familiar to many of us listening to this podcast. But the impeachment of Andrew Johnson was surprise, shock, and alarm, very politically motivated. There can be an argument, of course, that Johnson really didn't behave, you know, very well. He became very combative and confrontational. One could argue that his political bearings were not exactly good because he could have easily understood what was happening and simply played along. But Johnson was really not interested in helping. And more importantly, I personally, and what I have read and studied, I see a man who really honestly felt that it was his responsibility to make sure that the South didn't have any more reasons to hate the North. And since he himself believed in the inferiority of African Americans, he believed that not only should blacks be kept subordinate to white people, but that doing anything else would have ignited greater angers in the South. So you see the this cartoon by Thomas Nast, considered the father of American political cartoons, referring to slavery as dead with question marks, is really telling you everything you need to know about what Johnson was trying to do. So freed slaves would not achieve equality now that they were no longer bound to their masters. In some ways, their situation was worse. The church became the center of freedmen society. By 1890, over 13% of African Americans in the South proclaimed themselves to be Baptist. Due to the denomination's centralized structure, marriage, which under slavery had been illegal, exploded, with the majority of former slave families living in a two-parent home by the 1870. Communities also worked to establish schools to educate freedmen. This is what I remember, the Freedmen Bureau. Efforts faced pressures from whites in the South who feared that educating blacks would cause them to seek better social and economic opportunities elsewhere. For the South, labor shortages was a genuine, terrifying fear that they had. And so for Americans, for African Americans in Southern politics, it's really about ratification of their voting rights. But many of the guarantees that were offered by the Constitution could only be guaranteed to blacks with the presence of Union soldiers. And even then, it didn't work. The KKK and the White League, which are prominent features of that era, are just a straightforward example of how weak the federal government was, even within the military occupation. People have sometimes asked me, why would these white men go into the trouble of cloaking themselves and all the rest of it? And it wasn't just some sort of a silly ceremonial garbery, which I'm sure there is an element to it. But part of the Reconstruction legal structure, white males who participated in the war or who were a part of Confederate governments or regimes were not only under sort of suspicion, but they had their civil liberties suspended. They weren't allowed to vote. They weren't allowed to hold office. And until the state was reconstructed, they were technically considered on what, let's call it, double secret probation. Any running afoul of the federal government could garner somebody a judgment of treason, which would have meant hanging. And so to be identified by the Union of such behavior was quite literally lethal. So they disguised themselves. It is also true that they wanted to, quote unquote, scare black people. But the idea, of course, was that they had to avoid recognition because they would have been violating federal law, especially under the 14th Amendment. So for the religion, many of the denominations prior to the war had split into Southern and Northern factions. And for most freedmen, the Civil War was a gift from God, veritable proof that he cared for them and was looking after their best interests. We are going to see, for instance, the emergence of very strong African-based denominations. The African Methodist Episcopal Church is perhaps the most well-known. And there, so with the 15th Amendment, this guaranteed federal level the right, at the federal level, excuse me, the right of citizens to vote regardless of race, color, or previous condition of servitude. But former slaves had been registering to vote and voting in large numbers in state elections since 1867, as we can see here in this scene. Again, because the 14th Amendment made them citizens. Here we can see what we refer to as the Reconstruction banner. If you look at this, you'll see that Frederick Douglass in the middle, Blanche Bruce on the left, and Hiram Revels on the right served in the U.S. Senate. Frederick Douglass in the center was a major figure in the abolitionist movement, obviously. Down below in the middle there, I never realized this, and what I had read here is that is Brown from Harper's Ferry. This idea, of course, upper right there is U.S. Grant, who is going to be the president at the time. But this is celebrating all of the freedmen bureaus, the black soldiers that fought in the war, the sacrifices that they made in slavery, and their advancement into full and equal status in the country. And now, here we go. So during Reconstruction, any person who had held a role in aiding the Confederacy was barred from holding a political office, right? As I had stated earlier. As you can see here, those are the five districts that were broken up until the states were reconstructed. And what happens is that a number of Northerners are going to flood into the South in the hopes of making a quick buck. What had happened is the devastation of the South was so significant and prices collapsed throughout the South, particularly for land. So a lot of Northerners who, as I stated earlier, had maintained their wealth for the most part and had sustained their economic realities had windfalls of money that they then decided would go down and make investments in the South. And for these individuals, they didn't even really necessarily plan on staying very long. And so Southerners labeled them carpetbaggers. And a carpetbag was literally a sort of like a shoulder tote bag, like a small carry-on, if you will, case, quite literally made out of carpet remnants. And so the idea or the imagery here is that somebody just threw a few things into the bag and tore off for the South and make their quick buck and then just go right back home again. It's a term that we still use in politics for people who move from state to state in order to find a favorable place for them to get political office. You might remember that when Hillary Clinton left the White House as first lady, she moved to New York. And all of a sudden, she was a candidate for Senate, and some New York Republicans referred to her as a carpetbagger. Scalawags, on the other hand, were even worse. These were Southerners who betrayed their roots and sided with the Union during the war, or people who had immigrated to the South just so they could take position that Southerners could not hold. So the radical Republican record, however, I'm not really sure that it bears much praise. There's so much of it that's incomplete and not very well done. More importantly, I don't see any real significant drop in the Southern resistance. In a new book by Ron Chernow on Ulysses S. Grant, there are exceptional chapters in there about how Grant agonizes over these realities. At one point, he has to send troops back into Southern areas to fight these vigilante groups and arrests something like 3,000 plus people under federal statutes. but trying to keep tabs on him was just impossible. What's remarkable and something I really didn't know until I read Chernow's book is that there was actually an attempt to annex the country of Dominican Republic. They actually had a vote in the Dominican Republic where they approved a resolution to ask for statehood, and Grant had supported the idea of statehood because he believed that there had to be some place where African Americans could go and live and be truly citizens of the United States without having to fear for their very lives. Imagine a president thinking that way and yet not being able to really do anything significant to help. It's a very broken record, if you will. And so whites in the South will use their positions in order to, quote unquote, redeem the South and to rid it of its sort of black menace that they believed was there. They were also referred to as the Bourbon Redeemers. And these are the people who are going to, quote unquote, remake the South. And so for many African Americans at this point, the dilemma was, how do you find a truly free new life in the United States of America? There were some who literally got the clue, if you will, or got the message and literally walked away. The Exodusters out of the Book of Exodus is a group of African Americans who literally left and moved to the West in order to become pioneers, just so that they could, get rid of this hatred that was surrounding them every day of their lives. Now, none of this would have happened without Northern indifference. And I think it's really important to acknowledge that for many Northern whites, the real plight of African Americans was not a priority. This is because of just a demographic thing. Most white Northerners didn't even know a black person, seen one, been around one. But many people in the North really didn't think that African Americans were equal to them. I brought this up in the earlier chapter about, the Northern anti-slave movements. Just because you don't believe somebody should be a slave doesn't mean that you think that they're your equal. And so this is just a very, formidable truth. I think two other things, though, do have to be mentioned. One, war weariness. Many Northerners suffered a great deal. I think it's important to understand that the death tolls in the North were significant. There are some historians who argue that there's not a single family in the North that didn't have some sort of connection to the death of the war. I mean, it's just an unthinkable Iliad of death and destruction. And so for many Northerners, the idea that they had to keep fighting the South and drag them kicking and pulling back into the Union, it left a really bad taste in the mouths of many Northern whites who just really wanted the whole thing to be over with. And then the last of it really has to do with the economic plight. It becomes important because doing Reconstruction was expensive. Keeping troops in all of these states, having governments to oversee these Reconstruction projects, and to, try to educate African Americans and get them relocated to areas where they could be most productive and not as in much danger, was an expensive endeavor. And a lot of people just didn't like that amount of expenditure. So when Grant runs for election in 1868, he's pretty much a shoo-in, right? Although he had never been elected office before, Grant was elected the President of the United States based mainly on his victory in the Civil War. He was the youngest president at that time, and was often blind to the forces of politics once in office, and awestruck by the wealth of some of his supporters. I mean, he basically goes on a victory tour, and people just shower him with all kinds of gifts: farms, animals, money, gold, stocks, and he takes all of it, right? So following the war, the United States had $432 million worth of greenbacks that were in circulation, and the government debt was considerable. And so the Grant administration had to figure out how to get the country back together and find some sort of a rebalance, as you will. And so once the war was over, the idea was that the greenback paper money was supposed to go out of circulation and be replaced once again to return to specie, which means gold and silver. Democrats, however, had advocated printing more money to pay off the debt. This is going to become a third party called the Greenback Party, often referred to as the Ohio Idea. So the Grant administration faced a series of scandals, and it was really having to do with the quality of people he put into office. So one of the things that I think becomes significant is that Grant tried to run the White House the way he ran the war. As a general, he wanted to be able to walk into a room, tell his underlings and his commanding officers what was the objective for that day or that week or whatever, and then he meant for them to simply go do what they had to do, and he wouldn't have to worry about it. But the Crédit Mobilier scandal and the Whiskey Ring scandal, these all get traced back to either Grant's family or workers close to him, and this significantly damaged his presidency. I will say, however, not enough to get to stop him from getting reelected, which he gets elected quite easily in 1872. But those scandals definitely lowered his respect among the American people, and certainly among Southerners, who already hated him because of his role in the war, resented him because of his support for African American civil liberties and equal rights, and the idea that they couldn't vote against him because many of them had been disenfranchised because of their role in the war. The white terror that I had talked about, you'll see here another cartoon by Thomas Nast, the KKK and the White League. This was Nast's cartoon chiding the Ku Klux Klan for promoting conditions worse than slavery, which was what the name of this cartoon was. So the Congress is going to try to stop this. The most famous of the groups, obviously, the Ku Klux Klan. It was dedicated to wiping out those they viewed as dangerous to the South, whether they were freedmen, carpetbaggers, or scalawags. Congress does try to combat this. They're going to pass three different what are called enforcement acts, which were designed to protect black voters. And as I stated earlier, it proved to be rather futile. And so here we have an engraving from Harper's Weekly in 1872. It was done to try to elicit Northern sympathies to the dangers faced by freedmen in the South. So Grant is confronted by reformers within the Republican Party. Grant was embraced by radicals and then sort of pushed away by radicals. The radicals themselves became, I would say, somewhat overzealous. Now, what happens is the split in the Republican Party led to the creation of a faction of the Republicans called the Liberal Republicans, which I know sounds like a contradiction of terms today, but they were called the Liberal Republicans. And they nominated Horace Greeley, who was a writer for, I believe, the New York Herald. He was famous for this line that he'd written about for young men who really wanted to find a new life for themselves and new adventures. He has the famous quote, "Go West, young man." And Greeley had been a major contributor to journalism during the war. And so what happens is the Democrats, who saw an opportunity to take back the White House, also nominated Greeley for their ticket. And however, Grant still won. And I would argue that he won primarily because of the African-American vote. There is a conservative resurgence. It's primarily in the South, really, but in the North as well. Now, what's going to happen is a panic occurs in 1873, and the Republicans get blamed for that. And so in 1874, the Democrats took control of the House of Representatives. So at the time, some greenbacks were still in circulation and were traded lower than gold. But when Grant demanded that the greenbacks be redeemed, the so-called Redemption Act, for the same value, meaning funding at par, parity shook the economy again, and the Depression continued. So we have this panic. Some people are going to call this the crime of 73. And so what happens is Grant, who at one point, by the way, was considering a third term, decides that it's not going to be possible for him to go forward. He also begins to become ill with cancer that will take his life. In 1876, the Republicans nominated Rutherford B. Hayes for president, and the Democrats nominated Samuel Tilden. Rutherford B. Hayes is an interesting character. Tilden had been a loyal Democrat and had been part of the war faction and was quite popular. Rutherford B. Hayes was seen as a big reformer within the Republican Party. He wanted to reform the civil service, the so-called spoil system. And he wanted to bring more accountability to the government. And so he and his wife were teetotalers. They were members of the temperance union. His wife will be called Lemonade Lucy because she wouldn't even serve wine during meals, even if it was an official state dinner. And so some people refer to him as Rutherford Behaves. And so what happens is the election goes through. When the election returns were announced, rival returns from the same state posed a quandary. Which electors would go to the Electoral College? Finally, Congress established an electoral commission to canvass the results and declared Hayes the winner. Now, a secret deal with Democrats was later revealed, in which the Republicans where the Democrats agreed to go along with Hayes as president if Hayes agreed to remove the last troops from the South. The vote in the commission was 8-7, and now Rutherford Behaves becomes Rutherfraud Behaves. Some people refer to him as his fraudulency or old 8-7. And he's going to be a lame duck president from the very moment he takes office. This backdoor deal is often referred to as the Compromise of 1877. And so we get this another Thomas Nast cartoon, talking about the sort of blood deal made simply because they feared a return of the Civil War and violence among whites. With this, this brings us to the end of 1877 and the end of our early American history podcast. I want to thank you for listening. I hope that it was helpful and maybe a little entertaining for you. Please leave comments if you wish. And please look for my future podcast coming out called Modern American History Podcast. This is Don De Angelo, professor for U.S. history. And I hope everyone has a good day. Bye-bye.